Tech Cocktail Sessions, educational and inspirational talks from experienced startup founders, entrepreneurs, and thought leaders.
Let's hear it for Andreas Morano. Moreno.
Thank you. Yeah. Moreno.
I did a little reverb. Okay. So let's start with a little bit of background. So, how many people here are familiar with Open English? Pretty much everyone, so that's great. Do you guys know his backstory, how he got this started? How many people know how he got started? Three people? Four people?
Okay. That includes my mother.
Then your mother. I love her. Thank you for coming. Did you fly here together? You're here.
No, she lives here.
Oh, you live here. Okay. Yeah. Perfect. Great. So let's step back. You got this company started. Where did you start the company?
Yeah, started in Caracas, Venezuela. So an unlikely place to start an internet company, right?
Yeah. So just was it out of your apartment? Like, what was the kind of backstory?
It was actually. So I had started a company before that called Optimal, and we taught English to executives at Fortune 500 companies in Latin America, and it was just such a, you know, so hard to actually make the service work, right? You have all these executives at companies, you have to take teachers there in buses, and it was just very inefficient. And when I used Skype for the first time, I realized that we didn't need to actually bring the teachers to Latin America. We could actually do all this online. And so that's where the idea for Open English started. I had dropped out of school, so my mother was actually quite upset at me that I had started my first company. And then just as the second company was starting to do well, I quit at that also. So she was doubly upset at me. And then I said, no, but this third's a charm, Mom. Don't worry. I'm going to really start Open English. And so I did, and quickly realized that it was going to be a lot harder, and it was going to take a lot more work and a lot more money than I thought. So I went through all my savings. Wow. and I started out of my apartment, and I actually started at one point paying the programmers with like my suits and my shoes, and so which is great because now I don't own any, right?
Wow.
So, so it started out very much a garage kind of startup, but from an apartment in Venezuela.
And what drew you to? So you started there. You were kind of how far along did you get there?
Well, so I did 7 months of development out of my apartment. Ultimately, ran out of space there, so we rented the apartment across from us. The building didn't really like us. You had all these programmers eating and sleeping there 24 hours. The main perk was actually had this lady that would come in and cook for us. So Alicia would like cook the rice and beans for everybody because we didn't really have money to pay anyone. So that was very much that environment. We were running kind of like internet cables and wiring all across the apartments. And then 7 months in, we ran out of capital to fund this thing.
Wow.
So I started raising money in Caracas, and quickly realized again that raising venture capital in Venezuela was like, you know, a very challenging thing to do. And I think there just isn't a culture of venture capital in Latin America. So people will give you money.
Right.
Usually 50K will come with, it will cost you about 51% of your company.
Oh,
so
wow.
Exactly that, actually. So you know, realizing that they're reading enough blogs and realizing that there had to be a better way to raise capital for an internet company, decided to actually take my buddy's offer to go live in Silicon Valley.
Oh, okay.
And he said, look, I have ample room here, so you should come and raise money here. I know a lot of people. So I did that, and my friend Grant, I arrived there and realized that he had a really not even a studio, it was kind of like a kitchen with a bed, and he had a couch, but it was outside. So that's where I slept for a few months. So I slept on his couch for a while. I would wake up every morning with the one remaining suit, and I would go to things like this and try to sit next to people that look like they would have money. And I got really good at like taking people for 50 grand. Yeah.
How did you identify that?
They had to look like Matt, you know. well dressed, clean cut, you know. That's
money guy, right?
Yeah, I'm the money guy right there, right? So I started raising basically angel money, and it took 2 years, but I raised $2 million for Open English.
Wow,
at that early stage.
Years.
Yeah.
Wow. So you didn't give up. I mean, that's a long haul for...
You know, we did the values at Open English some many years later, and our seventh value is we never quit. So
right.
we're relentless about what we want.
What was the other value?
The other seven?
Yeah. I would like to hear them. Yeah.
I don't actually know them all by heart,
okay.
I think. But they are... I could recite them if you give me an iPhone. But
okay.
Look, there are things like we're all artists, so we're very creative at Open English.
Yeah.
We're all about collaboration and open and honest conversation.
Yeah.
So we're all about openness and honesty in the office. So there's a few others.
Cool. Really cool. All right. So along that stage, when you were like raising the money for 2 years, I assume it wasn't all yeses.
No, a lot of no's. A lot of no's.
What was that like? What were some of the bigger ones that kind of stick out? That you're just like, that was a critical no, or whatever.
You know, so the no's I don't actually, you know, I think you kind of forget over time because there were so many.
Right.
But I'll tell you a couple of kind of like life-changing yeses.
Okay.
How about that? And because I think that you over time, as you start a company, you become you kind of, you know, I think place a lot more faith in life or in God or whatever you know choose to believe in. But there were so many opportunities at Open English when we were about to die, right? And early on, companies are very fragile, so you don't have the money. And right now, we have a big bank account and a big balance. And, you know, for something to happen for the company, it would have to be really a lot harder for it to fail. But in the early days, you know, $50,000 can put you over the edge.
Yeah.
It's a big deal.
Yeah.
So I remember one time where we were still working for my apartment, and I had run out of money. And I remember going to my parents' apartment and saying, you know what, you were right. I shouldn't have dropped out of school. I shouldn't have started or quit the second company and started this crazy internet idea from Caracas. Like, how unlikely was that?
Wow. And
yes, because I had to now fire all my friends and close the apartment and do the thing that, you know, I had to go back. And I didn't have any clothes, and I had to go back to live with my parents, which was, you know, as much as I love them, you know. So it was not something I was aspiring to do after all that work. So and anyway, I go to sleep thinking I'm going to have to close the office the next morning and tell everybody that we're going to let them go. And I get a call that wakes me up, and this call is from like a bank, from a local bank as well, that had put in a credit line request like 6 months before.
Wow.
And they get me out of bed to tell me I had gotten approved for, remember, it was something like a $5,000 or $10,000 credit line, which at the time was like, oh my gosh, this is like 3 weeks, right? So that kept us going, and after that we got somebody else to invest, and that fueled us.
A local bank,
bank, right, out of all things. A second time where that happened, I was in LA living at this point, in between San Francisco and LA. We had completely, you know, run out of money once again, because we were, you know, in one of those stages. We had probably invested $300,000 to $400,000 into the company, and we had one of these challenging things, which I think some entrepreneurs here would relate to. We had to pivot the business model. When we started, we had a different name, we had a different business model. Actually, we were going to make English free to everyone, and we were going to basically collect money on advertising by basically doing what you just did, plugging American Airlines. So we actually had a lesson where so we had a lesson where, you know, you could actually learn how to fly on an American Airlines plane, learn keywords, and that sort of thing. It was a terrible model because people spend a lot more time on social media and check it 20 times a day, whereas they only learn a couple times or two, three times a week maybe. So it wasn't enough, and the audience we were getting was very scattered across the world. So, you know, I think advertisers want, how many eyeballs do you have in Miami, right? That's what's valuable. So we had people from all over. So anyway, that didn't work, and you know, it's a little bit challenging when you already raised almost $500,000 and you have to tell your investors,
we're not doing that anymore,
and by the way, so you don't lose your first $500,000, you're going to have to give me another $500,000.
Wow.
So it's always a bit of a tough pitch. So they had said initially, no, we're not going to give you another $500,000. I'll cut my losses with you. Gosh. I was suggested to me that I go to a men's retreat, which was a first for me. It was a Christian men's retreat. And you know, this is the last thing you want to do is like shut off your phone and go for a week into a men's retreat to talk about like your personal life or whatever around a fire with some other guys, right? But anyway, I'd really had no one else to call or try to, you know, get money from. So I decided to follow the advice, and I went to this thing. And you know, over the weekend, people tell kind of where they are, and I told the story and kind of where I was going through. And that was one of the guys there, an investor from LA, gave me a ride back home from the men's retreat. Mm-hmm. And you know, and he said, hey, why don't we grab breakfast on your way home? And I said, yeah, sure, let's grab breakfast. Yeah. So he sat there, you know, he looked at me, you know, we were at Starbucks, remember, and he just dug into his pocket and pulled out his checkbook and wrote me a check for $50,000.
Wow.
And said, hey, you know, I really believe in you, and I want you to continue this because I think it's going to be a big company. So those big moments. And, you know, happy to say that investor made, it's great. And that investor, fortunately, did not lose his money, and he made probably 30x on that $50,000, and we paid him back. So that paid for his kids' education and some other stuff. So it was a good bet on his part, fortunately.
And that helped you, I mean, propel you past that hurdle, right? It was a low.
Yeah,
and
it did.
Have you had others like that along the way?
You know, they've changed. I think the challenges don't disappear. Actually, they get bigger. And what's that expression? More money, more problems. So you heard that from a rapper somehow? Yeah. It is a tune, I think. But it's very true. And I think as you have more money, I think the problems just become, it's not about $50,000, maybe it's about $50 million, and so or 50,000 students and whatever. So, you know, and it really, the challenge is always, always shifting. and change. And you know, look, at this point, I think capital has not been the issue. Fortunately, those are some of the challenges early on. I know as early stage entrepreneurs here in the audience, that's probably what we're trying to do, raise money. I can tell you, you know, we've now raised probably $130 million from a number of venture capital firms.
What is it?
Yeah.
$130 million.
So, you know, it turns out that raising 50K gives you a lot of practice,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, right,
so,
yeah.
So yeah. It was a walk in the park when I walked into these venture funds. Yeah.
Right.
No, yeah. So, but the capital is no longer the issue, right?
Right.
You have other issues. I mean, I think we've been growing at over 100% for 4 years in a row, and you know, for example, keeping those expectations in the face of investors and is always a challenge.
So talk about size then. So 100% growth on the business side or team side?
On everything. So just to give you a few stats in open English. So we're now we have over 200,000 students enrolled in our programs. Our students pay about $1,000 a year to learn English with us. We have about 2,000 people working at the company. We have 7 offices. We have 150 people working here from Coconut Grove. Our management team. We built a great team here in Miami. We have 7 offices kind of all over the region.
Wow.
We're operating in 30 markets. We have like 92% brand recognition thanks to our commercials all throughout the region, so you might have seen a few of those. You know, that kind of differentiates us from the competition a lot. And continuing to grow. Last year we enrolled 95,000 students in 30 countries, so it was really exciting.
Let's talk about how did you do that? Like, obviously it wasn't just like a walk in the park. So what were the first steps to get that kind of traction?
You're gonna have to be more specific.
Literally getting that $50,000 check to like, it didn't go directly to $130 million raise. I mean, you didn't go from like that to like, your, you know, 7 offices and, you know, whatever. How did you, what was the next step? Like, what's that next step?
Sure. You know, so that's a great question. And today, you know, I try to spend some of my time with entrepreneurs, and a part of that was kind of invitation from Knight, and they invested in Endeavor and invited me on the board, so I'm doing that as part of my time, which is great. And you know, and I think to be successful as an entrepreneur, I think you have to really focus on what exactly you need to get to the next stage in your development, right? And I think when you start a company, you have this grand vision, which you should have, right? And I think and you want to do all these 20 different things, but the reality is that you may only need to do 2 or 3 things to prove whatever it takes to get to that next level, right? So for example, I'm using Open English. Maybe when I started, investors in the US didn't understand or believe that people wanted to learn English online or that they could.
Right.
So actually building an MVP, a minimal viable product, that allowed teachers to communicate over the internet with a student and teach English, that was already proof of concept that you could do it.
Right.
And maybe having 1,000 classes out there was a proof of concept that people actually wanted it and there was a man. So that got us to kind of raising our angel round. And then what's next? So maybe investors in a round A, they want to know that there's actually a market there, right? So how do you prove that? Well, let's prove out a conversion funnel. Let's spend $100,000 in marketing and prove that you put $100,000 to the top of the funnel and you get a million out, or you get $500,000 out. How do you do? Well, do you market online? Do you market on TV? How do you convert those leads, et cetera, et cetera? So maybe that proved that there was traction in the marketplace enough that, okay, there's proof of concept on the demand side. So you raise your round A. Your round B, then you ask yourself, how do you do that? Well, now you need scale. And so they give you $10 million. Okay, knock yourself out. Does that conversion funnel, does it have depth? Can you actually go from 2,000 students to 20,000? And if you can, then maybe you can raise your round C. And off you go, right? And I think in our stage right now, as we approach, you know, kind of the next stage of Open English, which could include an IPO next year and certain other interesting kind of transformational events for the company. You know, it's can you build a replicable, scalable, predictable business model, right, around some core KPIs that are very easy to digest and understand to public market investors. So I think being able to do that is not just kind of the wild, wild west of growing quickly. It's really how to achieve operational excellence in the process as well.
And then you just mentioned something, storytelling, like telling that story to the public is going to be a little bit different, right? Like, it's not the same story you tell them, that regular investors, right?
Well, you know, I think fortunately, you know, we have a story that everybody kind of understands, right?
Yeah.
You know, English to emerging markets online, like, why didn't anybody do that before?
Right.
So I think we have that to our advantage, right? It's a very obvious model. We're not doing, you know, infrastructure servers, you know, for, you know, whatever. I think the challenge, I think, is sometimes people understanding the demographic and how transformational English is.
Yeah.
to their lives. I think if you live in the U.S., you kind of take English for granted. In our case, I think conveying to our investor set that people actually pay $1,000 a year, and $1,000 a year to learn English online, it just seems like a C-class, right, you know, student in Latin America doesn't have the money or would never do that. And the reality is that, yeah, in their case, that they're willing to share a big part of their disposable income on education.
Okay. You mentioned briefly commercials. Can you talk a bit about some of these commercials? I haven't seen them, but I've heard a lot about them. So some of these commercials, they all include you.
Most of them, yeah.
Most of them.
Yeah.
All right. Have you seen the commercials for opening? Pretty a lot. Okay. Like, so there's these. Just give a quick update on where those came from and what it's all about.
Sure. So I see the people that raise their hand are smiling.
Yeah.
They know rechiken and persuasion and all these funny words. But we did something that was a little counterintuitive at the time. We decided to go on TV, which for an internet company, everybody kept counseling us that we should market online. TV is very expensive and it's very hard to scale, et cetera, et cetera. But we really thought that we wanted to establish an emotional connection with our consumer and really communicate the need for English beyond just kind of a flashing banner ad or an SEM search word. So we did this, and we thought that we wanted a really creative type way to do that. We didn't really want to do an infomercial like you would traditionally do here at Rosetta Stone or others. You know, we wanted to actually connect with that inner core need and fear of speaking a language. So we realized that happened at the time when an executive would stand up in front of his board and have to speak, and their palms would get sweaty and they would get red and the words wouldn't come out. And it was that moment that we tried to capture through humor. And we thought that humor could actually be communicated well throughout many different languages, accents, and territories. And so we came up with this concept. If you remember the kind of Mac versus PC ads of the kind of in the 90s, we came up with a character that, you know, takes English for the traditional school, and the guy's like always late, has a stack of books and photocopies, and has a kind of a teacher that, you know, has a terrible pronunciation and teaches them really useless stuff. And then there's me, that I play the character, not the founder of the company, but the character that actually takes English with Open English. So I'm always like at home in a bean bag with a pina colada, and I'm talking to Jenny, my cute teacher from California, that's like blonde, blue-eyed. So this kind of like that image really capture the consumer. and so that's how it started. And we started doing these kind of funny portrayals in 30 seconds of what that is. And the commercials have become very popular. We release a new one every month. The last one we did got 12 million views in 24 hours before airing on TV, just by putting it on our Facebook page. So it's really funny. And now, you know, in Latin America, the brand again has 92% brand awareness. And the story has really, thanks to the fact that we're on TV so much, has really been kind of synonymous at this point with entrepreneurship, as people know that I'm also the guy that happened to start
that's
the company.
That's great. I'll have to definitely check that out. So that's like not a usual approach, right? Like to take that commercial approach. Seems like it's working. Let's talk about Miami a little bit. 2009, you decided to move to Miami.
Yeah.
Why?
You know, the nightlife, the girls, no. I moved to Miami because we were, you know, so I was in Silicon Valley, and flying from Silicon Valley to Miami to Sao Paulo to, you know, Buenos Aires was heavy, heavy duty, yeah. So I decided that Miami was a much better place to do that from. Okay. That was one, so geographic location. Yeah. Second, talent. Actually, there's great talent here that's Portuguese, Spanish speaking. There's seasoned talent. I mean, Miami has been the home to many global companies that have placed their Latin American headquarters here. So you can find deep marketing, PR, finance, resources, at tax, admin, et cetera, that understand the region. And it's actually, in terms of recruiting people from other parts of the U.S. to come live here, and even Latin America, Miami is a very desired place to live. So we've brought a best-in-class team from all over the U.S. and a seasoned two-time company, IPO company, CFO to Miami. The CTO from Riverstock.com has come to Miami, all for different reasons, but they love it here, and they're having a good time. And you know what? It's easier to retain talent here than it is in maybe Silicon Valley or Boston or New York, because there aren't that many offers out there.
Right. No, that makes sense. And what's it been like? I mean, from 2009 to now, I mean, I've only been involved in a short time in Miami. Yeah. It's already seen changes. What's it like for you, like 2009 to now?
It's really changed. I mean, I think I was, look, I'm very complimentary of what the Knight Foundation has done here, and Matt's here with us today, but I mean, he can tell you, but I mean, two, three years ago, nobody would associate entrepreneurship with Miami. I think this would have never happened. Nobody associated tech startup with Miami. Mm-hmm. And look, we just happen, I think, to be in the right place at the right time, and we're an example of that, and it's fortunate for us, and fortunate that we can add value in that way as an example to the community. But at the end of the day, what's happened here is a very coordinated plan that was put in place by by Knight and some others in the community to really highlight the success stories, to foster, you know, entrepreneurship, to create a place, a common place where entrepreneurs from Latin America and the U.S. could come and share stories, could actually raise money and start companies and have the support they need, not just capital, but actually the social support they need, which is part of what Endeavor is all about, right? Having a board of directors and a board of mentors that can help you navigate through these tough situations that you go through at the beginning.
Yeah, actually that leads into my next question, which is about scaling and funding, like here locally. How was that for you? Like once you got here, like was it hard to scale here? Was that, you know, challenges that proved?
You know, when you're raising money as a growth stage company, things change, right? In our case, we went from taking 2 years to raise $2 million. I mean, the last round, which was $65 million, we did it in 2 weeks, and it was a preemptive round. The VCs flew here to see us, and we got our kind of pick of the litter. So I think once you're bigger, I think there isn't geography is not an issue because these bigger funds will travel, and I think, you know, a quarterly board meeting, you know, is enough for them to monitor their investment. If you're an early stage entrepreneur, I mean, it's a little different, right? Because the VCs want to actually come by your office after work and see that you, your friend, and your dog and your PowerPoint are still there, and so So I think in that I think that's still challenging. Having said that, you know, I think that I think that the toughest thing to solve for is actually those initial $2 million that you raise as an entrepreneur, because once that gives you enough capital to prove to succeed or fail, right? But you'll prove that there's a business model, a product, and hopefully a demand, and then you can actually go and raise around A, around B. And there is enough capital now that is smart capital, that understands how to fund technology companies, that is here in Miami, that can raise $2-3 million for a startup early on. And so I validated it myself. I helped start another company, and we just raised $2.5 million for it in a couple of weeks. And,
from 2009 to now, it took you 2 years. Now this took you 2 weeks.
For that first raise, so the second company I started, it took 2 weeks to raise $2.5 million.
So let's talk about that a little bit. What is the second company?
Well, so I realized at Open English that there was an opportunity to really tap into this aspirational need to kind of for emerging middle class consumers to transform their lives in a different way. And so English does that, right? If you learn English, you'll probably be able to earn 30-40% more living in LATAM. But you need more. You're still a taxi driver, you're still a call center rep. So we wanted to figure out how can we transform someone from, you know, taxi driver, hopefully bilingual taxi driver after Open English, to actually maybe a bilingual web developer or a bilingual video editor or a bilingual designer. And so we started picking some degrees that we could teach online, that we could democratize the access to that with great content, great teachers, but at a very affordable cost. The delivery system would be the same type of platform as Open English, and we're very good at marketing and selling, so we could really get the word out in a very efficient way. And so that gave birth to Next University, which is the first online university in Latin America that offers these certificates for careers that did not exist 10 years ago. And that's started. There's, again, in a couple weeks, we raised $2.5 million for that. We have a CEO that's working here in Miami. He was one of the top five execs at Pearson. Left his job at Pearson to come to Miami and run the company. I have a day job, so I'm on the board. And we have a team of 13 people already working on it from the Grove.
Awesome. Wow, that's great to hear. So it's literally an extension of what you've already learned from this other experience to kind of take it on to the employee side.
It is, and you know what? That proof of concept that you can take a great idea, you know, pair it with a great management team and fund it with enough smart capital to make it successful through its early stages. Informed the third project I'm involved in, which is a venture builder.
A third project.
There is, yeah. I don't sleep much. No. there's a third project, which is a venture builder that we're starting in Miami, and I've committed $1 million of my own capital to fund it and start it, and talking to the community to see kind of how to best put that together. But there's a managing director already involved that we're going to announce for the next 30 days, and I'm really excited. We're going to try to do the same thing we did at Next University with other kind of tech-enabled services that are focused on Latin America as a gateway, and that focus on education and healthcare, which are two big areas of opportunity that are kind of underfunded in the region.
So you're looking to seed fund, is that what you're saying?
Well, no, it's different. So an incubator will give, you know, $40,000-$50,000 to companies. You have the venture fund that'll come and invest in a company and take a carry. We want to actually be the ones that build it.
And so it's a hybrid model. So somewhere like are you familiar with Science and Santa Monica? It's kind of like they build products.
Something like that. So imagine if you can replicate that same Open English experience or Next, where you have some of those same cogs at work, right? Kind of a B2C tech-enabled service for that consumer. And other categories or areas that are of high demand.
That's great. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. Okay, so is there anything else you're working on?
You know, but professionally? No, not professionally.
So we talk about scaling, we talk about your startups. There are a couple other things I wanted to ask you about, but let's talk about your management style. Like, it sounds like you're pretty busy now with like all these different things happening. If somebody had to describe your management style, what would they say?
I would, let's see, that's a good question. I don't know. There's nobody in the audience from our management team. Good, okay. So, they won't raise their hand and debate, liar. So I can say all great things, that's good. The interesting thing, even with Next University, I think if you hire great people, right, and you empower them to make good decisions, and you are a good partner to them and advising them through that process, I think you usually get to good results. So I think words like collaborative, generally helpful, and very involved, yet, you know, easy. I delegate a lot. It would come to mind in some of those conversations.
Is there anything else you want to talk about? So we can open it up to the audience and ask questions all day.
I mean, let's do it. Yeah, let's open it up.
The only thing was that somebody mentioned the black tie array. I don't even know how to approach that. What is that?
There was a lot of drinking, so I don't know how it ended. No, just kidding. One of the exciting things. You asked me other things I'm doing. Okay. So I am definitely very involved in the Miami ecosystem and bringing entrepreneurship to Miami. And part of that is actually being able to leverage what Miami has to offer, right? So, and one of those things that Miami has to offer is like a great nightlife and a great scene to come and have a good time. And so instead of trying to paint Miami as this kind of square place, perhaps with a bunch of scientists, let's just paint it for what it is. It's a lot of people that I know. You know, we do know how to have a good time, and we live, I think, balanced lives with a lot of kind of full range of experiences, right? We work a lot, but we also have a good time, and we like to be outdoors, and so I think that is what can attract the right talent to Miami, and the Black Tie Rave was an example of that. So we did a friend of mine, Ian Shevlin, who's the chairman of Tech Week, and also a partner at Guild Capital. You know Ian? Okay. So Ian had done Tech Week all across the country in different cities. Chicago, yeah, exactly. And so we invited him. I invited him to come spend time in Miami. And after using my guest room way too often, I told him he should really get a job here, do something. So not just the weekends and have fun. So he decided to bring Tech Week to Miami. Yeah. And so it's kicking off this week. And so I'm really excited about Emerge Tech Week. And so we put him together with Manny Medina, and we was already kind of working on Emerge. Yep. And now it's Emerge Tech Week. The conference is going to be super exciting. If I don't know if you guys are already signed up to go, but there are a lot of speakers that are going to be really interesting. Yep. But anyway, so as part of this initiative, we wanted to do a kickoff party, and we had almost 300 people come to my place, and we did the Tech 100 awards for kind of top talent, in Miami and in South Florida,
and then Kim Cup thing.
I didn't.
You might get a little glass.
I did. Well, I
was really surprised.
So we did that, but the black tie was actually, we did this party. We brought a couple DJs, a singer friend of mine, Elise, who was singing vocals to the DJs, and everybody had to dress up in gowns. I and all the guys were dressed up in black tie, and we were able to bring in, and as a result of the party, we brought a bunch of entrepreneurs from Silicon Valley, New York, and other communities.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Next time you'll get an invite.
Thank you. Yeah. To get my black tie.
Yeah, you gotta get your tux out. Yeah.